Okay. Yeah. So I had picked up a bunch of like camera and microphone and everything, and was going to have that all set up for to do this, like good quality, but just wasn't able to get it going on this. So you guys got to stand by as we start this series. We want to do this as a weekly series. So we're going to always post up a Reddit thread and get that up on Reddit for the whole week, and then just kind of commit to just having something on here for Fridays, and we're just going to be answering any questions you guys have through the week, and then I can check on this on the chat, I guess it'd be chat over here, how to answer any questions you guys have, and then ideally what we want to do is bring in some of the other team and maybe try to do some split screens and maybe focus on certain things that folks are working on. You can ask them directly, that kind of stuff. So we just really this was one area of the project. We've been trying to get some other stuff done, but this is an area we've been missing. Just putting a face to the project. You guys read a lot of stuff we're doing and we talk in chat, but like there's something about just hearing how the project's going, answering direct questions, and just being, just being available for you guys. So that's sort of what this is all about. And we're kicking it off. So I apologize for being a little bit late, but I think we can kind of get going on it. So we had set up a AMAFAQ thread, and you guys posted a whole bunch of questions. So I was just kind of gonna start tackling those and kind of expand on some, I think, that more than what we talked about inside the thread. So one of the first ones, well, let's go with let's sort it by first come, first serve. So oldest first. Okay, so one of the first ones was, will Particl copay ever support staking? And again, a lot of these we answered on the thread. Oh yeah, sure. Okay, so I can introduce myself and what I do and all that stuff too. Good point. Okay, so my name's Paul Schmitzer, and I'm head of communications at Particl. And I've been in the crypto space for, a while, 2011 or so, and we've written a few blogs, but I kind of head up the communications. We have a team that we're starting to build where we're getting into community managers. We brought Crypto Guard on. We have Christina and James that are going to start helping with social media. We've got a bunch of volunteers, Kapoor and BB2K, who kind of are helping with the educational side and tackling some of the analysis and that kind of stuff with, like Kapoor's got a really great, technical background and analysis, and then BB2K's does great tutorials, really wants to do more, just kind of an educational piece for both those guys. So we got a handful of guys that are starting to help out tackle a bunch of the communication stuff that we need because we got a big marketplace coming up. That's sort of what I do. I don't have a I'm not a developer. I do, I have a background in architecture, but I have been in the space for a long time. I've been an investor in a bunch of projects and still am. And again, this is I covered this in one of my blogs, but this is one of the first projects that I really gravitated to, and just by volunteering and just trying to help how I can, just kind of build into where we were going to do something new, and got invited in to help, help with that. So it's been fun, and we just got a ton of stuff that we're excited to push, and that we have pushed. I think a lot of you guys have been real pumped about the just what we were able to do in 6 months. And we've been just real cognizant of ask or using what we've been given to deliver what we promise and to you know, manage that the best way we can. So you know, hitting deadlines and delivering on those, and you know, doing a bunch of firsts for the project, for Bitcoin, for crypto in general, all of that stuff. You know, yeah, that's one of, you know, we're just excited about that. So so that's sort of who I am. I don't have any guests today, but it looks like we may end up doing this on YouTube. It seems to be the overwhelming favorite over Facebook. So we'll fix that and get that thing going for next week. But let me go ahead and start getting into the questions. And then at the end, let's start answering some chat questions. And I think some of the team actually might be in the chat room. So let's go ahead and I'll tackle some of these, and you know, we'll go from there. So let me go ahead and jump into that. Okay. So first question is, will Particl copay support staking? And so the answer to that basically is, I answered it on there. It's one of our wallets that you can use to participate in the cold staking, but the wallet specifically won't do, it's not set up to do staking by itself. So the cold staking actually is not available just yet. Rhino's been working on the copay app, and he's working with the BitCore wallet services module, so trying to get that set up, and then there'll be a new release on the Particl copay app that'll let you use that as part of your cold staking setup. So yeah, it looks like about 35% of the network right now potentially set up with cold staking, which is awesome. So you know, it's a security thing, it's a privacy bit, it's, you know, you get the same rewards and that you're getting with the regular staking, but you know, it's just a level higher with security, and you know, you want to protect that. So it's one of the reasons we set it up. And as you guys probably saw in some of our posts, you know, there's benefits to it. It's quantum resistance, you know, which is basically, for those of you guys that are trying to figure out what that means when we say quantum resistance, Particl is not a quantum resistant coin. But we do have a feature, which is the cold staking, which protects against any kind of, you know, attack that we could get on staking through the quantum quantum computers. So basically the way it works is proof of stake coins just are constantly sending their keys out to, well, not the keys, but the hashes out to the network just to validate, to be able to get that reward. And it's just a constant thing. So along with broadcasting that information, that's tied to a wallet that actually has all your money in it, all your tokens. And so, you know, that with computers getting faster and faster, that's definitely an attack vector. So Technovert and Shazzy kind of came up with a way to get a smart contract in there, a script basically, where you get a wallet and you get a staking node, and you basically set those things up, get them to where everything's converted over to a cold staking, you know, address. It's activated, and which I said about 35% of the networks like that right now. So you get it all activated over to there. Then you could basically have all your coins into a wallet, which could be offline. You don't need it online. And the only thing that staking node's continuing to broadcast is its own hash. So that could be broken down, and you could get the private key and all that stuff through there. But there's no coins on that. So a hacker would only have access to, you know, that information that's on that, which basically would be nothing. At least not your Particl. So it's cool. But on top of that, and then you have the fact that there's, you know, the big Meltdown Spectra bug that came out. And actually, in that kind of a setup, you're protected against that as well. And, you know, with that meltdown in Spectra, if your, I guess, raspberries aren't affected by that bug. So if you're staking regular on top of that, you know, in on a raspberry, then you're okay with that too. Now, and then just to nail down, like, we're not saying we're quantum resistant coin. It's just a feature that is quantum offers that security, because once you spend those particles, so you stake that, once you spend it, you're just as vulnerable to a quantum computer attack as every other crypto that's out there. So once you broadcast that, you're kind of unknown until you spend, and then once that's out there, that can be, you know, compromised. So that's sort of to explain that part. But to answer the question, Copay will be available to work in that's in the cold staking, but you won't be able to stake on there. Cool. Okay. Another question kind of related to that is cold staking pools, which is really cool. You know, that's something, especially as Particle's been growing in price, it's expensive to be able to get. You know, we have a 5% coin increase over the first year, but it starts to get kind of expensive as far as getting enough to be able to make any kind of, you know, life-changing passive income off of that. Not that we're in here to, you know, change lives in that sense, you know, versus privacy and stuff, but, you know, that's definitely an intrinsic value on Particle. So the idea of cold staking pools or even staking pools is a good thing, as far as that would be just like a mining pool. You have a small hash rate, you can join together with other folks and actually benefit from that. So you have a large pool of coins that are staking and you get a percentage of that. Now, the team is not going to, at least right now, we're not going to be building one ourselves, but, you know, we'll support any person that wants to do that. We'll be able to help you set it up or offer assistance in setting that up. And but, you know, ideally, we'd like to have the community developers or whoever it is set up, you know, cold staking pools that people can join. A good example of that's Decred, who has some they have staking pools. I apologize. They have staking pools. And so you could do a shout out to like Willy Woo or someone like that, who actually is he participated in our token exchange as well back in the day. You know, I think he set up a Decred staking pool. So give him a shout and say, hey, man, I heard you like Particle and we need some staking pools. Let's get that started. So, you know, that would be a great thing to see developed. So we're here to support anybody that wants to do that. It's not something that we're going to be doing ourselves, at least right now. That's not on the plan. That's not on the docket. But it's support. It's able to. There's nothing we need to do to the code to allow that to happen right now. So people could do, you know, set this up right now. Another question: can we expect a fiat on or off ramp with Alpha? Probably not. The only reason is because this is we're building a minimal viable product. We're building a an MVP, and so part of that's like, you know, how do we build out the buy sell, you know, that contract and everything like that. Having the ability to on or off ramp with fiat. As far as, there's a question later about governance, you know, all those things are part of the plan. But as far as the alpha is going to be pretty bare. And it's just basically to show you, look, this proof of concept, this is what we've been working to build, get all that in there. And then we, you know, fix all that up for the beta, plus add some enhancements with the beta. Then the next release will have some enhancements. The next release will have some enhancements. So, one of our core values is crypto agnostic. Part of that's accepting other crypto coins, plus part of that's being able to use fiat and all that without PayPal. So it's part of the plan, but it's not necessarily going to be in the alpha release. I would plan that the fact that there won't be a fiat on and off ramp, at least in alpha. So let's see. Another version of that, I kind of answered this on the thread. I won't get into too much, but atomic swaps and that kind of stuff, that's a way to do it too. There's ways to integrate other projects, coins, so you can, we can fill that vision of being or core value being crypto agnostic. Atomic swaps, the Lightning Network, using exchanges like Shapeshift and Changely, stuff we've been saying for a while. Maybe even, centralized exchanges potentially, that kind of stuff. All that's, we want to do those kind of integrations. So those are in the plan. But again, not probably for alpha. So alpha's just to get that MVP out. Okay. So in here, there's a good question about, let's see. So there's a question about how are DNSs paid? So a DNS is a data network solution. And basically, that's how all the listings are held and everything. So the way Particl does it is we're SMSG, is kind of like our version of BitMessage. And that's how we store listings. That's how you communicate. That's how listings are broadcast. And all that information happens on there. There's questions in this about scalability and, stuff that Bitcoin's dealing with and that kind of stuff. So I'll try to address all of those. But, Particl is still so young that we, and we don't have as many transactions on here, that we don't have to worry about that just yet, scalability. But, we are always keeping that in mind. And the fact that we're building utility on top of a blockchain, we need to definitely have that in mind. We need to have systems set up to be, if we have to, be agile and change things depending on the amount of people that are coming in. We don't want to slow everything down. But at this point, we're scalable to be able to do that kind of stuff. And we don't really have any kind of dilemma as far as block sizes or, our DNS, like storing messages and that kind of stuff. So we'll address those as they come about, but there's no worry that at this point, it's definitely a trending topic as far as Ethereum's having the problem and Bitcoin, but Particl's not seeing anywhere near that amount of transactions on its chain. So we have we have time to get there. We have time to format a plan. It's kind of good to be in our position because we can see the struggles that other projects are having. And sometimes that quick adoption, which is awesome for price and just notoriety and, just kind of people talking about it all the time, like that comes at a cost sometimes too. And when you're scaling, some of these projects are, Bitcoin's been scaling for a while, but Ethereum or different things where, some projects like CryptoKitties or something brings you to your knees, or a new ICO brings you to your knees or something like that. You have to have safeguards in there. So we have time to work through that, but which is good. There was also, Ido came in, one of our developers, Code, he came in and, answered some of these too. And one of the old legacy parts about the SMSG from Shadowcash days was the fact that everything was held for 48 hours. So it's like a two-day period. that limit's not in there anymore. So as you're kind of going through this and people are talking about, you know, how long things stored and everything like that, that's, there's no 48 hour limit anymore, just so you know. I might need to rearrange these. Everything coming in clear and stuff so far with you guys? Okay. Let's keep going here. Okay, so we have a question. How about chat widget? What's the functionalities it'll carry? Again, you know, there's already SMSG is our, you know, platform, is our system for transferring communication and eventually listings. That's in the core right now. So we're starting to see a lot of some SMSG transaction or communications happening on the chain. That's sort of happening. It's picked up the last couple weeks. I think that's the team starting to practice or starting to, you know, go put it through its paces. There's not a ton of folks in Particl, at least right now, that are using the command line interface to send, messages and stuff like that. I think everybody's sort of waiting for the Particl desktop to show that. So there's an uptick in SMSG messages and that kind of stuff. And I sent a message out to Pierre, who's on the team, if the new desktop that's coming out has that built in. And I don't think it has it built in this release, but we are planning on having that. It, like I said, the back end's there. It's just building it into the wallet. So you can go in and do secure communications right now, like today, if you can do it in command line, on the CLI. So we're building that into the wallet right now. I don't think it's going to be in the newest release, which we're actually going to be putting out a new release in the next couple days, I think. We're just kind of finalizing the bugs in it, but it's going to be specifically for testnet. And that release is going to be a name change also from Particl Wallet or the Particl GUI Wallet, or, this is the Electron and Angular wallet that we have. We're changing that to Particl Desktop. So that's sort of like our flagship product. It's one, the first of its kind, the Electron and the Angular wallet in the crypto space. We have the other wallets, the QT, the CLI, Copay. So we built four wallets last year. The Particl Wallet, which is the GUI, that's always been kind of like the main product. That's the first product we want everybody, when they come to the website, they want to get started in Particl, that's the wallet. So we're changing the name over to Particl Desktop because it's more than just a wallet. The wallet was great to for as we were using it for Particl and stuff, but we're building utility into the blockchain, so we're going to have that marketplace. That's going to be part of the Particl Desktop. The communication, that was one of the questions, all that's going to be within there. So there's going to be a name change. And actually, if you go to the GitHub, it's already in there. Some of you guys might have noticed that already, but I think it's a really important, it's a great name for it, and it explains everything that needs. I think as people come to the website, they're going to see, Particl Desktop. That makes sense. It's not just wallet. And then, okay, well, how do I get the marketplace? So it's all within there. It's a nice package. So that's a new thing you see. So hopefully in the next couple days or so, we'll do a testnet version of that, have that for a couple days on testnet, then we'll launch it live. But it has a lot of the bug fixes you guys have been reporting. Thank you. And things that we've been trying to fix and some enhancements and stuff. So another question, when will we see the staking widget? So right now that's not set up for the new release. However, if you run cold staking or if you run Shazzy's Party Man, there's staking stats in there. And he has a built-in web server inside of that, inside of Party Man. It's like Party Man. But so he, I'm trying to get him to do a guide where we can do the web server. But I think you can set up a local web address or pump it to a web address where you can get stats on your staking node. But that's through Party Man. Eventually, that's going to be within the Particl desktop. Right now, this new release, it's not part of that. Okay, any progress on the Ring CT audit? The researcher, I think he pronounced it Kwan. He is with New Jersey Institute of Technology. If anybody's kind of new to the project, you know, we set up a research grant with his team. He's got a background in cryptography and security, and you know, kind of like you really fit the bill for someone we wanted peer reviewing this code that we put on, which was Ring CT was developed by Shin Noether from the Monero Labs. So he developed that at Monero Labs, and it's the same privacy that Monero uses. However, they build it on CryptoNote. Technovert ported it over, and it's the first implementation on Bitcoin. Ours is. It's been on testnet since we launched, and you can still use it right now. So it's Ring CT, which is the, you know, privacy that Monero has, that was developed by Monero, but on the Bitcoin code base. So, and it's on the latest Bitcoin code base because we keep up to date with the Bitcoin core guys. So one of the only projects to do that. So it's up to date, you know, it's all on there. So what we ended up doing was we, with New Jersey Institute of Technology, we set up a grant. We actually set up two grants. The first one is in the process right now for those guys to do a number of things. One of them is to peer review the Ring CT. I think Rhino and Hank, last I heard, have a meeting with him today. So I don't have any new information right now, but I know those guys are meeting. So, you know, I'll happily relay any information I can get from that meeting. So, you know, there's a level of, I don't know how to explain it, but we that implementation, like, we really want to make sure that that thing's been hit by a number of eyes outside of us so that it's ready to put onto mainnet, because we're talking about a whole bunch of stuff, responsibility that we have. We don't want to just fling it, you know. It's one thing making it the first on Bitcoin and that kind of stuff, but there's a responsibility we take a lot of pride in anything we do. That's why we use testnet so much. Half the time we're talking about new products that you can't just have just yet because we're testing it still. So, and we thank you guys for all that testing. Ring CT is one of them. And even Monero didn't launch it right away. I think they had a good, you know, year or more of reviewing that. So even though they've had that, you know, we're using it on different protocols. So it needs review, and we're not in a hurry necessarily to get that out. It's great PR. It's great, you know, like, look at us kind of stuff. But it's more than that. It's you know, part of the privacy that we're building on the Particl, and we take it real serious. So as much as we'd want to just shout from the rooftops, hey, it's on mainnet, if it takes time, it takes time. So those guys have a meeting with him tonight. I'll be able to share more on that as I find out. How about exchanges? That was a hot topic through here. You know, we have been talking to exchanges since we started. It's a crazy space right now. These exchanges get, I'm sure, just hit with requests all day long. I mean, their whole staff is staffed to run an exchange, not to hear all these projects that want to be listed onto it. And it's a real problem. So we've seen fee increases from exchanges, just asking a lot of money to be listed, more than you would need to be listed. You know, in the past, we've always offered our services to help people. And we still do that, you know, with Bittrex, we help them, and Bisc, and, you know, we're helping with Komodo and Barter Decks right now. We've been talking with those guys for a number of weeks about getting into their decentralized exchange. So we, you know, we're happy to do that. And we talk to almost every exchange that's out there. We've talked to them, and we continually talk to them, and we've talked numbers with them, and we've talked, you know, we've answered like tons of paperwork. It's a big process. So we're committed to doing that. And the reason we're committed to doing that is not for speculation. It's not to raise the, you know, get listed on Binance so that the price 10 times and that kind of stuff. That's not why we're doing it. We need exchanges, we need integrations and all that stuff so that we have liquidity and volume on Particl, on the Part token. You know, we need it for the marketplace. The marketplace needs to run. We're going to be bringing in other coins into the marketplace. So there's a use case for all, for everybody's coins. If you love Dash or you love Monero or Bitcoin or whatever, Spank coin, you know, the plan is the marketplace is a choice for you, for everybody to be able to use it. You know, this is for the crypto space. To make that happen, how it needs to happen, we need liquidity and we need volume. And being on just a couple exchanges isn't going to do it, especially exchanges you can't really get on right now. So that's part of, you know, we have Imran, who's IMYB on all our chats. He's kind of our business strategy guy. We've brought in Charlie Shrim, who along with mentoring and that kind of stuff has a lot of connections with businesses, exchanges. He's part of projects that are integrations we want to bring in to the marketplace. So, you know, we're taking these steps. We've got guys on it. Ultimately comes down to the exchanges, and we can offer as much as we want. We can offer to pay what they're asking, all that kind of stuff. But we, you know, until they actually do it, or until they actually say go, it's 100% on to them. So we've made ourselves available to everybody that you guys are suggesting or point us to for a number of months. And it just takes time, apparently. So some coins seem to get on real fast. I'm not sure what that's all about. We're hoping having the advisors that we have, that helps, you know, Particl with that. Ledger integration, Technovert, that's one of the many things he's been working on. I think he hit a little bit of a bump with the Ledger integration, and then he's got other things that he's working on as well. So I haven't heard the latest on it, but I know that he was in the middle of doing it. I'm not sure where that is right now. I'm not sure if another priority has taken precedent over it or not. So, but that's one of our things that we want to do. Pierre on our team is friends with the Ledger guys, and we've talked to them, and their recommendation is we do the integration and help get that in there, and then we can to them, that was the easiest way to get onto there. A lot of these other projects, they pay a set fee, and you get so many nanos, and that's sort of how they've done it. Their recommendation to us was, Pierre, who they know, and he was like, you guys do the integration. That's the way that ideally it should be. So that's what we're doing. Okay, and then there's a question, when will Particl have bulletproof CT, which is one of the new research pieces that's out there. If I'm not mistaken, because there's a handful of different things out there, I think that is about the transaction sizes, I believe. which is basically confidential transactions and ring CT transactions. They're about 20 times bigger than a normal transaction. So we don't have them as default because our blockchain would go crazy, which you can see Monero is only 3 years old. They have a huge blockchain because a lot of their, 100% of their transactions are confidential or anonymous. So their every transaction is 20 times bigger than necessarily would be if it was, say, Bitcoin or some other coin that's based on the same code base. As a responsible team again and stuff like that, we, you know, plus we have reasons why we don't have everything private. One of the big ones is the size. Well, Bulletproof CT is some new research now that the SegWit, I think it's this, the SegWit 2x or whatever it was, now that that drama's passed, you're seeing a lot of the Bitcoin research come back out. Because they were dealing with a whole bunch of drama that, you know, there was a threat to a lot of the Bitcoin, everything that took all of them off the actual research and improvements that they typically do to crypto. You're seeing a lot more of that come out. Bulletproof CT is one of those. I think there was something else where they were dealing with something, but trying to improve, but basically these are going to cut down on transaction sizes. And, you know, we have a plan to always research this kind of stuff. I put a feeler out to Technovert to see if he was actually on it. I haven't heard back yet, but I assume he's already kind of looking into this research already. And, once that's done and everything, I think that I could see this being we have to create a new roadmap, our next roadmap once the market's out. That's going to be a 12 to 18 month kind of projected roadmap. I could see Bulletproof CTs being onto that, plus a number of these other things that people have brought up. There's a couple that we hadn't even thought of that were great. Okay. It's running not too bad. Okay, so there's a handful of questions that were really good, and so one of them's about transaction. We kind of hit on this a little bit too, but transaction fees, transaction times, and exchange availability. So I did the exchange thing. Transaction fees, nothing set. So Particle's been rising, costs more money to send Particle. You know, as that starts to, you know, we're always keeping an eye on that. If that needs to cut back, you know, if Particle is continuing to grow and it's getting more and more expensive just because of the transaction fee that's tied to every transaction is growing, you know, we can fix that. So that can be either one of the new Particle improvement proposals that we've done. That we set up on it's github.com/particle community. There's a PIPs thing in there, so anybody can set up an improvement proposal. This would be an improvement proposal I could see someone setting up, or we would set up where you know, there's definitely an argument about it costing too much to send because of the price. You know, that's something we need to look at. So nothing set in stone. You know, if transaction fees have to get cut down, they'll get cut down. So one thing to note when you send a private, I think this is still true, but typical Particle transaction versus a confidential transaction, I think the confidential transactions are about 100, they're either 10 or 100 times more expensive. So so there's a, you know, it costs a little more because they're bigger transactions too. Transaction times, that's something I could see being a 12 to 18 month roadmap deal. So you hear a lot about instant transactions, you know, like just kind of like they're done. You don't have to, no confirmations, that kind of stuff. works really good with sort of the stuff we're doing as far as building a marketplace, you know, your commerce, that kind of stuff kind of makes some sense to not have to wait for anything. That could be part of, you know, a 12 to 18 month. That's not one of our priorities right now, but I could see that being something where we'll look at. Right now, when you send part, it's pretty much instantaneous. If you send it to friends or anybody like that, you get it right away. The thing that I think this is addressing is the confirmation time. So typically you want to, you know, 2 to 3 in there. So particles, they have blocks every 120 seconds, which is 2 minutes. So you're waiting, you know, for 3 confirmations, that's about 6 minutes. You know, if we were doing instant transactions, that would be, you know, different. So, you know, I think it's something to look at. I haven't seen anything from the team as far as having them yet, but, you know, for what we do, I could see us doing that. Let's see. See if there's any others that really stand out. If not, you know, we could ask some questions on the chat too. There's a question about atomic swaps with multiple hops. We don't do that right now, but it doesn't mean that we're not going to. If you guys haven't read the Reddit thread, there's VIRTD. He had a couple really good points and left some good references for source material for looking at stuff. So if you guys looking for something to read, I need to check it out too. But Stellar has cross asset payments, which basically, you know, there it looks like it's like a multiple hop or like pathfinding where they choose the there's multiple ways to get to an endpoint. It chooses the cheapest route to get there, and looks like it can do 6 hops per swap. So we're not doing that right now, but it's interesting, and you know, we could look at it. He also brought up, or they also brought up, quantum resistant signatures with a link to a proof of work article. Well, it's not proof of work, but it's specific to proof of work. I think every project, just my 2 cents, every project should be thinking about the quantum computing that's going to be coming out in the next 10 years or so, or faster. The setup we have now, like I said, explained earlier, that's, you know, there's a vulnerability there. There's an attack vector there that exists right now before quantum computing is available. You know, the vectors, you know, the signatures that are sent. This talks about quantum resistant signatures. We haven't looked at that yet, but could be something, you know, we looked at. It looks like I had answered that, but it looks like they had answered back that Cardano is starting to look at that. So that'll be good to look at. And QRL, which is a project that's all, you know, like their focus is quantum resistance. Looks like they have a white paper on it. So something to look at. I haven't looked at this yet, but it's very intriguing to me. There's a question about atomic swaps on mainnet. So we haven't done, our atomic swaps have been on testnet. We haven't done any mainnet swaps. There's been a couple public ones from Bitcoin to Litecoin and Litecoin to Decred. And, you know, we made a decision that we didn't, you know, when we were doing the test net with Decred and doing the peer review, we kind of, you know, that had happened, that stuff had happened, you know, a few weeks earlier. We felt like, you know, jumping on that and doing the same thing just didn't seem like it'd have the, you know, it might make a little bit of a bump and, you know, definitely be something to be like, yeah, we did it. But, you know, wasn't something that we felt it was more important. And, you know, we got a lot of positive pushback of, you know, doing the angle of integrating with teams and having that peer review. So we kept everything to testnet. So we haven't done that. That could be something we revisit after the marketplace gets put out. Right now, that's our focus on everything. There's a question about integrations with exchanges, which we kind of talked about already, but we have a couple on our Twitter. We have a few wireframes about how we could see integrating Shapeshift and Changely. I could probably post them on the Reddit too. It would be an in-house sort of exchange versus, I mean, that's sort of the vision that we have as far as framing it out and how that could be worked into the Particl desktop. Does your development team have a bug bounty program? We don't, but we should. We rely on you guys to the community and the developers to help squash bugs and, you know, break things and report it. So we like that. To me, that seems like a volunteer sort of thing, and we appreciate all of that time you guys spend for that. But there's another level of that, which is like there's some, you know, large bugs out, and sometimes you can draw the attention of people that can help fix those or point them out with bounties. So a lot of project teams have those. A lot of real companies have those. I think it was something that we had in the past, and I think bringing that in is something that definitely would be worth looking at, even if it's like, you know, like a vital, like a critical bug, you know, you should get rewarded for that versus just little kind of menial, or not menial, but little tweaks sort of stuff. Question about Charlie Shrim. So all our advisors are on Particl for reason. So we brought in Micah and Jan and Joe at the beginning for specific, you know, for what they did, the value they brought to getting Particl off the ground. We've brought in Miguel and John as advisors, and, you know, they have connections out in the Philippines, which is, you know, a huge market for remittances and, you know, trying to get connections through there. But, you know, they were supporters of Particl before they came on. Charlie's the same way. You know, he's a privacy guy. He's, you know, was a fan of what we were doing already. He has specifically, since that's what the question's about, he has, you know, he's an entrepreneur and has been in this space for a long time. He's got a background that, we can really, it fits with what we're trying to do. You know, we're trying to integrate with other projects. He's got projects that he's started or has advised that have done that. we want to do this in the crypto space. He's worked in the crypto space, obviously. We see him as sort of a mentor. We see all our advisors as a mentor aspect. Charlie specifically, when we brought him on, we felt like it would be good to try to get him in on some meetings on a regular basis, just to leverage sort of his knowledge. So he comes in, the plan is that he's going to come into some of our meetings and talk about that. And then also, he's, you know, I talked about this earlier, but exchanges and integrations and partnerships with companies and different things like that that'll benefit Particl as we're building our decentralized economy and as we're, you know, becoming a use case for other projects, that value that he would have, we're trying to leverage that to help, you know, with getting on exchanges and different things like that. Just getting, it's sort of like a stamp of approval, I guess. A lot of times advisors are like that. Not that we're using them, you know, these guys are actually fans of what we're doing ahead of time, or helped us start it up. And you know, he's one of those guys too. So that's sort of what he's doing. I think we're, you know, with all those guys, you know, getting as the marketplace comes out, I think you're going to hear a lot more from them. So right now, you know, we've got to deliver on that. I think once that's out, I think you're really going to see a lot more play in the Particl and talk and that kind of stuff. So, because to be honest, you know, right now the marketplace is still vaporware. So, you know, we haven't seen, you know, we've done pictures and that kind of stuff. So nothing really out there yet forever, seems like, for all of us. So we got to deliver that too. But I feel like a lot of, I feel like this question's directed at the fact that he's not necessarily talking about us, or we're not getting into projects that he's advisor on. That'll come in time. You know, I think some of that, again, is related to getting the marketplace out, focus on getting that out, get that MVP done, and it'll come. There's a question about the Particl developers staying up to date with Bitcoin Core. That's one of our core values, is security. So you'll see that the Particl team will either be the first or one of the first project teams to be upgraded to the latest Bitcoin code every time. So they come out with something, that's our mothership, that's our code base. It's, there's a reason we chose that over Ethereum, there's a reason we chose it over anything else. A lot of it, most of it's due to the development, the hardening of the code, the longevity it's been, what it's been through, all of that stuff. So that's a very important to the Particl team. The Particl dev team, we've had three updates, I think, since we built it off of, we built Particl off 14.14.2, which is what Litecoin's on right now. We built it off of that, and we've upgraded three times since, I think it is. And we've done that within about 10 days of Bitcoin Core being out. So Litecoin's still on 14.2. And then obviously other projects are, they kind of fork and then that's it. They stop. You'll see that a lot. What really gets me, I don't understand it at all, is you get projects that are brand new, but they decide to build off of a code base that's like years old. So you got projects that are building off of 0.13, even 0.12. And it makes you question, like, what are they doing? You know, would you build a brand new Windows app off of like Windows 95 or something, or would you build it off of Windows 10? You know, you're going to want to build it off that secure piece. Or if you're building, you know, an Android app, you're not going to build it off of, you know, Marshmallow. You're going to build it off of whatever the latest, you know, flavor they got out is. So we started Particl from this, you know, the right at the latest. I wonder if it's because projects teams pick and choose, you know, like this has, it checks all these boxes. We don't have to do that. Let's do that. And then we'll just have a minimal amount of stuff, regardless of the security threats that it has. I'm not sure. I have to think that's probably what it is, because it seems random to just pick certain things. But back to what we're doing, you can guarantee that security is one of our core values. You can guarantee we're going to stay up to date with Bitcoin Core, and we'll be one of the first projects to do that all the time. So that's going to happen. And it basically, you know, it's a good use case, or I mean, a good example of this is projects that aren't on 0.15, like those projects are susceptible to that breaking Bitcoin bug that we talked about. Basically, people outside of you can shut down your node. So if you're mining or staking, any of that kind of stuff, your thing could be shut down from someone that's not even, you know, part of you. So on a bigger level, a ton of staking nodes could be shut down. Your network could come to a crawl. You could fork. You could do all kinds of stuff. There's like, these are core things that project teams need to consider when they're building something like a cryptocurrency project. And the fact that outside forces could cripple or shut down or fork your network, like, you're going to want to be on the latest thing that, you know, fixes that. So 0.15 for Bitcoin fixed that bug. Everything else, you know, that can happen. So anything older, the older you get, the harder it is to fix it. So good luck with that. Question about the marketplace. What's it pegged to? The marketplace will be pegged to We'll have something set up in there where the most stable currencies are the, you know, all our fiat currencies, even though most people hopefully are coming from cryptocurrency into crypto. And, you know, it's just, you don't have to get into fiat. We'll still probably peg the project, the prices to that. And just as a stability thing. So as people compare their projects to, or their products, so if you want to buy a new computer, you're going to want to compare how it is on Particl or Syscoin Market or Open Bazaar. You're going to want to see that compared to other things. Ultimately, here's my pitch on decentralized marketplaces. You'll never hear Particl team saying we're going to be the next Amazon. We're not going to overtake. Our vision isn't to overtake Amazon or eBay. We're going, you know, if that happens, that's awesome. But decentralized marketplaces, like what we're building is a choice. You know, for vendors, they're probably not going to stop on Amazon selling and just come to Particl. They're going to stay on Amazon selling and they're going to come to Particl and sell. And they're going to look at that and, you know, maybe they end up switching all over to Particl. But, you know, that's not going to, we're not going to change that. This isn't going to, you know, Amazon's an animal. I mean, they have more resources than us. They have, you know, shareholders. We're dealing with privacy like no other decentralized market has to deal with. So we have even a bigger weight to carry. We can't do things that make it super easy like Amazon does to, you know, to sell you products or program your mind to what you will like because you like this, that kind of stuff. You know, we don't have the ability to do that sort of stuff. But, you know, decentralized markets, just like a decentralized exchanges, they're a choice. You know, that's an option, a choice. So my hope is that even though, you know, we'll get into fights with Open Bazaar and, you know, Syscoin's Block Market and whoever else, as to who's better or whatever, ultimately all of us should be building a platform that's an option for people, you know, a choice for people to use. It's a different shopping experience, and you know, in our opinion, it's a better shopping experience because you're in control. You know, all those models, even you know, our competitors in the decentralized marketplace, all of those are trust model systems. So I'm getting ready to put a blog post out about this on Decentralized Today. But you know, when you shop online, there's at least four people that are involved in the process. So it's not you and the guy you're buying it from. There's a payment processor, and there's the people that are doing, the people that are running the site that you're on, right? So there's four people that are involved in something that should just be two people. You know, that's, there's all kinds of privacy issues with that. There's just a number of things. There's fees. There's a whole bunch of things in that system that it's just, you know, it's not a broke model because it makes a lot of companies a lot of money, but there's alternative, and that's where it comes back to choice. That there's the idea of the decentralized market, which is you have a choice. You could be in a trustless system. So Particl, actually, what we're trying to build is a trustless system, and it's really interesting because when you read Satoshi Nakamoto's white paper, you don't have to get very far. Just like the first two sections, the abstract, the very first section in the abstract, he says, you know, basically, the financial system's a trust model system. You need to trust them, and you can't, and you interact in that system, right? So there's, in a trust model, there's fees and other players, and they take their cut, and it's your money. You know, there shouldn't be that. And then the, you know, what he's building in the Bitcoin, with Bitcoin, is basically a trustless system. So, and that's succeeded. Obviously, we're all living in that, where it's peer-to-peer. There's no trust model. You know, there's nobody overlooking it. Well, if you go down to the introduction, then, you know, the very first sentence in that, he's talking about the same exact thing in e-commerce. So there's a trust model where you need Amazon, you need PayPal to be able to interact with people and buy and sell online. So what Particl's trying to do is we're like, you know, you can build a trustless system. That's why we have, you know, our smart contracts using MAD, the two-person escrow, the privacy side of it, and obviously the blockchain side of it, number of things. So with our escrow and everything, that kind of sets us apart from the other decentralized marketplaces, because they need moderators and that kind of stuff. So those are trust systems as well. So I don't know how I got on that tangent, but we were talking about pegging prices. But anyway, that's a whole nother discussion. The whole how many people it takes to play, you know, in e-commerce and what we're trying to do to change that. But again, it's a different shopping experience. It comes down to a choice. There's no way we're going to pitch that our system, our trustless system's going to, you know, is the one and only way. You know, there's people want choices, and, you know, it's the same with Bitcoin. It's been around 10 years and, you know, only a small percentage of people use it for what it's for, that, you know, trustless currency exchange. So, I think there's just a couple more on here. We are past the hour, but I'm okay with going a little longer if you guys are. We've got 11 guys on here. So what's the roadmap for the governance? Okay. So we just recently launched, we just put out a bit on Particl, github.com/particlecommunity. Where CryptoGuard helped, kind of helped, the two of us did this, where we set up two different types of proposals, a Particl improvement proposal, which is a PIP, and a Particl opportunity proposal, which is a POP, so a PIP and a POP. And we kind of set those up because, you know, we have decentralized voting on our network. There's a plan to do governance, two types of governances. They're going to be separate. So one's controlled by staking nodes, and that's the platform governance. So, and that would be related more to, like a PIP would be related to that, where you're improving the Particl protocol, the code. So if someone, say the transaction fees that was brought up earlier, you want to change the transaction fee setup, that's something that the staking nodes need to vote on. And it needs to start as a proposal, so as a PIP. So that's a governance model where the staking nodes have control, you know, they're, as long as you're staking, you have voting rights to be able to, you know, dictate where the protocol's going, the directions that it is. So that's what those are set up for. So that's the platform governance. The core team obviously is going to take, you know, we have a vision, we have a set of a core values. There's a mission to what we're doing, you know, right now is the marketplace. We're going to continue to trek along those as long the way too. But we're also in, you know, we want this to be a decentralized, you know, autonomous sort of economy. So, you know, we're setting up a system where people can propose changes and stuff. So that's what that is. There's another governance, which would be the the marketplace governance. And I wouldn't expect, that's not going to be, I already know, it's not going to be in the alpha release. Again, the governance side, you know, that's part of our plan to build that in, but what we're trying to do is the MVP right now, so we're not going to be like governance, that's a big animal right there, and and first we need to get the MVP in. We need to get the framework done. You know, I always bring it back to building buildings, the foundation and then the framing, then the skin and the pieces in it. So the governance module, that's gonna run the marketplace, you know, all that stuff. But that piece isn't going to be necessarily in there. Now there may be actually there might be sort of pieces in there, or it could be released with governance, but you only you have the ability to take on or off, say vote on or off items. That could happen actually in the command line interface. It's not, I know for sure it's not going to happen in the Particl desktop as we're doing that, because, you know, it's just, that's a whole nother level. We can develop the core back end, you know, that's easy enough to do, but it's a whole nother set of team and time and everything to build a pretty user interface on top of that. So those modules are always going to be lagging behind. But the plan is obviously just everything we've always said, and that's in the white paper and everything, is that, you know, we're going to have a system set up where the Particl holders are governors, and they have, you know, it's their marketplace. So they can vote off things that are sketchy or whatever like that, vote for or against and that kind of stuff. So platform governance and the marketplace governance with that. Again, the alpha may or may not have it in CLI, but I don't think I've seen any indication that it would be in there, but it could be. But it definitely won't be in the first desktop version of it. Let's see. Another question about the alpha marketplace launch. I'll just talk about that. The plan is that it happens this quarter. So there's no reason why everybody shouldn't be excited to see the Particl marketplace this quarter. So that's part of the plan. We've delivered all the way up to this point. If you watch the code commits, especially in the, it's github.com/particle, but with that, that's our main setup. But inside there's the dApp shell, which is something headed up by Ludex, and he's that's the back end. That's really far along. It's pretty much something where we could start showing some of that, what's going on, walking through the paces of how the marketplace can go through command line interface. You know, that stuff is very close right now to being ready. Like I was saying with the desktop, you know, adding that prettiness on top of that, that's what's going to be the next steps. So everybody should expect the Particl marketplace out this quarter. No reason why it shouldn't be. Now, again, this is an MVP, so it won't have a ton of, you know, I mean, it's going to be bare minimum without some of the, you know, features and everything like that, but that's what the beta's for, and that's what all the versions after that are obviously for. So but the long-awaited, you know, privacy marketplace, you know, it's this quarter, so that'll be good. That should get everybody excited. And then let me see, I think we pretty much got most of it done. I guess I would open it up to the comments if there's any other questions you guys have. I can answer because I can see the comments in here. Otherwise, we can save those for the next one. So my goal is to do this every Friday. So we'll do a whole new thread probably tomorrow that'll run till Friday. And we'll go ahead and set that up. We'll clear out all the questions. We'll probably archive these into a wiki. Well, we have a wiki on our Reddit where it has all our AMAs from the past. So we want to set this up to, it's just kind of, you know, getting a face to the project, plus also answering questions, just kind of just, you know, shooting the shit with you, talking. So we'll clear that out. We'll put a new thread in there. And that'll be live again, and I'll work on trying to make this on YouTube instead of Facebook. So the goal was to kind of drive more traffic to Facebook, but it sounds like just with users and everything, it sounds like YouTube's probably the better choice for that. So we'll switch that over. I think there's also a plan to maybe start bringing in other people. So that might happen next week, where we bring in maybe somebody from the team, someone else from the team, or a community member, or kind of do the first half as a AMA sort of FAQ section, but then the second half maybe talking about maybe we bring Kapoor in and talk about fundamentals and analysis. You know, I've talked to some of our big community guys, just, you know, either through a webcam like this or phone calls. And he's one of the guys that's a lot of fun to talk to. I would listen to him just for a long time. Like if he wanted to do a webcast, I'd probably sponsor it personally. So, you know, he might be somebody we'd bring in, or Jonathan, who's BB2K, another great guy to, you know, that's just like, you just sit and talk and, yeah. And these guys are real passionate about Particl and about what they do. So that educational piece, we might try to bring those guys in. I'd love to bring maybe Ludex in to talk about, you know, the marketplace stuff. So maybe that's someone we bring in. So those are kind of the plans for these. We want to just make them every Friday. I'm going to work on the video quality and the audio. Again, I apologize for being late on this piece, but you know, hopefully it was helpful. Hopefully we get more folks. We just had about, you know, 10 or 12, we're at 13 or 14 right now, but you know, get more folks in and maybe start lighting up the comments section, where I don't talk as much about what you know, I briefly hit what our questions are, and then we can get into some live chat or something like that. So that's sort of the plan for it. I appreciate you guys coming in. Thanks for sticking with me as I was struggling to get it set up right. If that's it, sounds like everything's good. I hope it was helpful. We'll do this again next week. So sound like a plan? Good stuff. Cool. Okay. Well, thanks, guys. I'm gonna sign this off. So it's about an hour and 15. So it's, you know, good view.